Okay, hello and welcome to COP 4708. In this session, actually in the last session, we talked about entities and that each entity has more than one attribute. So for example, if we are talking about like a student, then we are talking about the name of the student, maybe the street address, maybe the email, the city, state, zip code, so on. And all these attributes can form what's called a record. Usually we have many records in the same entity or for the same entity, and all these records can be saved in what's called a relation. Again, for example, we have the student, and the attributes could be the name, street address, city, state, zip code, email, and phone number. This could be also for a patient. This could be also for employee. So the same information could be collected for more than one entity. Other entities could be like aeroplane. Aeroplane is an entity, and I can gather the attributes for the aeroplane, or a car. And I can gather the information for the car, such as the model name, model year, and the maker. So we can collect many information about the entity. Now, the question is, how can we reach and retrieve a record from these entities? So if I want specific record, such as looking for John as student, or maybe looking for Mike as a student, how can I get the information just for Mike or just for John? I need to search within those records, and if I do that, oh wow, that could bring for us hundreds, maybe thousands of students with the first name of John. How about the last name? We will still have hundreds of the same last name, or at least few of them with same last name. So we need to search for an attribute that can pull the required records and determine all the information needed, and this attribute has to be unique. So when I use it, it will pull only one unique record, and we can call that as determinant or identifier, because it will determine only that record. So if we call it identifier or determinant, then it should be unique and can determine other attributes or columns in the relation. For example, I can use a student email, which should be unique, to pull all the information related to a certain student. So now this one is my identifier or determinant. This attribute actually, or this determinant, can be considered as a key. So it will be the key that opens the door for all other information related to that entity. It's considered the main key, or what we are going to call by the primary key. So this is the primary key for the relation. The entity that determines other attributes, I mean the attribute that determines other attributes in the relation, it's called primary key, which brings us to the definition of keys and how keys works. So keys could be a combination of one or more columns that is used to identify rows in a relation. For example, social security number. It can determine the information of a person, the name, the email, the address, other information for that person. And that's only one. The combination of maybe first name, last name could determine other information, although you know you can find it's not unique, and you can find other people with the same first name, last name. So we should find a different combination that can determine other attributes for that relation. If we use more than one column to determine the others, then we call it composite key. So the composite key composes or consists of two or more columns. We can analyze the different attributes and nominate some keys that could be candidates to be a primary key. So we can look at the relation, look at the different columns within that relation, and we can see which one is a candidate key to be a determinant for that relation. Although those candidate keys might not be used, but they are considered as candidates to be one of the primary keys. So the primary key is a candidate key that is selected as the primary means of identifying rows in a relation. Like we said, it's the key that opens the door to other information within that relation, to the other columns or the other attributes. There's one and only one primary key per relation. We are not allowed to add more than one. And I think from your experience now with Access and the data that we developed in Access database, you can see that you are not allowed to use more than one key. The primary key may be a composite key, and the ideal primary key is short, numeric, and never changes, such as social security number, maybe student ID, employee ID, patient ID, and so on. And we are not talking about only humans, because we can say, like we said, car, and the car has VIN number, and the VIN number can be unique. We have airplanes, we have products, any product that has SKU number, order number, invoice number, all these are numbers that are unique and can be used as identifier or determinant and can be called as primary key. Now, going back to our first example, we noticed that we have the attribute name, street address, city, state, zip code, email, and phone number. That's what you know I said in the first slide. Now, the email is considered a candidate key and can be used as a primary key, but is it an ideal key to use or to be the primary key? It's not ideal because it's long, it might have symbols, it's easy to make mistakes in that one, and by doing mistakes then you will not be able to match the different relations. So the best option, since you know I don't have any anything that can determine the record or a unique record, then I can add another column that is numeric and can determine other attributes, such as for example here, entity ID. The additional column will be considered a primary key, but it's an artificial primary key. It's not natural. It does not include, is not included within the information. And since I added that as artificial primary key, we call it as surrogate key. So the surrogate key is an artificial column that's been added just to be the determinant and to be the primary key for the relation or the database in this case. You will see later on that we are not only dealing with one relation or with one table. Actually, we will be dealing with more than one table. And those tables will be connected together. They will have some sort of relationship. And we talked about the relationship in the relational database model. And we said that we might have one-to-one or one-to-many or many-to-one or many-to-many relationship. So we introduced that relationship before. And we know that we will have more than one table or more than one relation. How would I connect two tables together? How would I know that from the information, student information as a table and course information as another table, that student John is taking these type of courses? Or how can I map these courses to student John? Since I have two tables or two relations, then at least one of the columns has to be common by the two. Since I have student ID as a primary key in the first table or first relation, which is primary key, I need to send an ambassador for that primary key to the other relation. Since I'm sending that primary key also in the course column or the course relation, then it will be foreign key. So the student ID is a primary key in the student information table or relation. At the same time, it's listed as an attribute in the course table. Since it's listed as an attribute, it's not a primary key because I cannot use the same primary key for the two tables. In this case, it's called foreign key. Foreign key is the primary key of another relation that's placed in that table to establish the relationship between the two tables. It is an attribute that is referred to in another relation, and it holds the same values, but it can create a relationship between the two tables. And we'll take examples as we go later on. I will show you examples on two relations or many relations and how we are using the primary key as a foreign key in the second table. Since we are using the same column in two tables, the same column, which is student ID in this case, in two tables, the table for student information and the table for course information, I have to enforce what's called referential integrity constraints. So when creating a relationship between the two tables, we have to make sure of this referential integrity constraint, which is a constraint that limits the value of the foreign key to those already existing as a primary key values in the corresponding relation. For example, if John is a student listed in the information table entity, and he has student ID, for example, 474808. Then I have to make sure that the same ID will be in the course table, because John is taking these courses. So I will point that student ID 474808 is taking those courses, taking these courses. And that's to make sure that this person is taking these courses. Again, I have to enforce that referential integrity constraint to make sure of the consistency of the data between the different relations. And we will see more than one example later on when we start building those tables and building these relations. So now we talked about the keys. We have the entities, attributes, and we selected one of the attributes as one of the keys that will open the door or determine other attributes. The next session will be talking about functional dependencies. That will be all for this session. Thank you and have a great day.